I guess we already have sufficient number of participants to get the session started with. So we won't be doing any further delay. So welcome to the session of machine learning using TensorFlow. So as you all know, we are going to have a 3 days event, and 14 and 15, we are going to have live session, and 16 we'll be having our speaker, Ms. Usha Rangaraju with us, who will be like taking a session on how to get started with Kaggle. And I'm sure you all are equally excited like the way we are to discuss and to continue our like this process of discussion and learning new things. So this is Priyanka Pradeshni Mahanti, member of Google Developer Students Club, and I along with my friends Lakshman Naik and Shuhak Swain will be your mentors for the upcoming 2 days. And as you all know, the agenda, I guess, wait a second. As you all know, like the agenda of our session, like the first 2 days, 14 and 15, we'll be having live session. On the first day, that is today, we'll be covering topics such as data ingestion, machine learning, and on the second day, that tomorrow, we'll be covering the neural network topic. And the final day, that is the most awaited day, we'll be having our speaker with us. And to conclude the event, we will be launching a competition, and the winners and those who like perform good in that, you will also be awarded. And the most important, like the motive behind this is not about winning only. It's like you will be getting a brief idea on machine learning, TensorFlow within this 2 days. And you will not just be, giving you the theoretical knowledge. We will be trying our level best to provide you the intuition behind that and like how this is used in our day-to-day life. So I guess let me share my screen first. And the most important thing, once I start sharing my screen, I won't be able to like see your chat. So I will try to ensure that while I'm teaching, I will be frequently checking the chats. But that because my team members will be like, they will be clearing your doubts in the chat box while I will be taking this session. Okay, so can you give me a confirmation whether we should get started or not? Guys, I'm waiting. Okay, fine. So are you all excited? Okay, cool. So is my screen, my screen is visible, right? Fine. So let's get started. Okay, so before getting into like a session ke andar jaane se pehle, like before getting understanding about the whole process which happens in machine learning, I want, like, before I explain it to you, to know from you guys what you think is machine learning, like anything which comes to your mind when you hear of the term machine learning. Let me check the chat box. The chat box is all yours. You can write anything which comes to your mind when you think of machine learning. Okay, we have one reply from Pratyush Singh, AI. Cool. Like you can write like kuch bhi definition bolo ya fir koi bhi word bolo. You can also give examples. Mimicking the human activities through machine. Okay, that was like a very well explained. Making behave like humans. Yeah. Prediction of future events based on past events. Yeah, correct. Getting output with, yeah, perfect. Tracking, teaching machine by analyzing data. Yeah, perfect. Like all of you have very well explained the machine learning, and like I didn't expect such great replies. And that's like very cool. I can really find that you all are really enthusiastic. You're really interested in this topic. So let's resume. As you already told, it's machine learning is mainly about making machines learn. So machine learning is a field of computer science that uses statistical techniques to give computer systems the ability to learn with data without being explicitly programmed. सो ये तो गूगल का डेफिनेशन है. लाइक समहाउ तुम सबका जो भी डेफिनेशन था उसको अगर हम सम अप कर ले तो दिस इज व्हाट इट मींस. बट हियर आई एम नॉट टू गिव यू दोस थियोरिटिकल डेफिनेशंस. आई एम नॉट हियर टू एक्सप्लेन ऑल दिस. आई वांट टू सेज मशीन लर्निंग इज एवरीवेयर. इट्स ऑलरेडी देयर. वी आर यूजिंग दैट. वी आर लाइक यूज टू दैट इन आवर डे टू डे लाइफ. एवरी सेकेंड वी आर कमिंग इन कॉन्टेक्ट विद दैट. लाइक आई गेस आई एम श्योर यू गाइज मस्ट बी शॉपिंग ऑनलाइन राइट. Let me see the replies. You guys are acquainted with online shopping, right? So, which sites you prefer for online? Amazon, okay. Myntra, okay, cool. So, while shopping, you guys must have absorbed that there is some recommendation section. Like when you buy something, you are recommended a set of other products also. Not just online shopping, whenever you watch movies in Netflix and Netflix or Amazon Prime or Hotstar, whatever, you will be finding a recommendation section. Do you find that or not? Have you seen that recommendation section? Yeah. So that recommendation section is also the example of machine learning. And I'm sure you, yeah, content-based filtering. Okay, we are not going deep into that. But yeah, that's the application of machine learning. Yeah, it's right, content-based filtering. So you guys at times must have got call from the bank or finance company asking you to take loans. किसी के साथ हुआ है कभी या नहीं? मेरे साथ तो बहुत बार हुआ है. Like they will be asking you about, yeah. Devas, we have Devashish who says yes. Anshuman has also experienced daily, yeah. So what do you think they will be like वो किसी को भी randomly call करते हैं and they are asking them to take the loans. Of course इतना time और energy तो वो बकवास में waste नहीं करेंगे ना. So what they do is that based on their previous history of the customers, they have a new set of yeah please I am Priya please yeah. So what I want to say is that based on their previous record, they have kind of analyzed the data and they have made a list of targeted customers and they think that like the targeted customers who are most likely to take the loans. So that's also the application of machine learning over there. And when we go to supermarkets, we can find that the chips bottle, sorry, chips packets, उसके साइड में normally cold drinks होता है. और तुम लाइक बिग बाजार मतलब लाइक नॉर्मल बिग बाजार चले जाओ या फिर कोई भी सुपरमार्केट चले जाओ, यू विल बी फाइंडिंग दैट चिप्स के साइड में नॉर्मली कोल्ड ड्रिंक्स का बॉटल्स रखा जाता है या फिर ब्रेड के साइड में हमेशा क्या बटर एंड जैम एंड ऑल दैट इज प्लेस्ड. द वे दे आर प्लेसिंग इन द सुपरमार्केट इज ऑल्सो द एग्जाम्पल ऑफ मशीन लर्निंग. अब तुम सोचोगे लाइक इस प्लेसिंग का क्या रिलेशन है मशीन लर्निंग से. एनी वन अमंग द अटेंडेंस हु कैन आंसर दिस. लाइक यू थिंक दिस प्लेसिंग ऑफ गुड्स इन सुपर मार्केट हैज सम रिलेशन. ओके दे टेम्प्ट अस बट या मशीन लर्निंग से. ओके मशीन लर्निंग कैन यू गिव मी द लाइक परफेक्ट आंसर. यू ऑल आर समहाउ नियर. लाइक मशीन लर्निंग का उससे क्या रिलेशन है अबाउट दैट प्लेसिंग. Making combination, okay, yeah, correct. So what they basically do is that they place important because the goods are placed in a way that, okay, fine. Yeah, market prediction or customer behavior. That's the like perfect answer. They have data what people buy. People are more like, yeah, perfect. So you guys have already answered it, but let me repeat it. Basically, what they have done is they have absorbed the customers' buying patterns. And using they are placing the things so that they could maximize their profits. Yeah, that psychological thing they are using also. Okay, so moving forward. Okay, so we like knew about machine learning. Like अभी तक तो तुम्हें पता ही चल गया होगा कि machine learning का कितना wide application है. So what do you think is the like the reason behind the craze of this machine learning? Basically, the way it differs from the traditional programming. ये फिगर देख के कैन एनीवन गेस व्हाट्स द डिफरेंस बिटवीन ट्रेडिशनल प्रोग्रामिंग एंड मशीन लर्निंग लाइक द फिगर सेज इट ऑल आई डोंट थिंक इट्स कंफ्यूजिंग आई नीड टू गो बैक टू चेक योर रिप्लाइज दो या लाइक ये फिगर देख के तो मैं लाइक व्हाट कैन यू कंक्लूड व्हाट इज द डिफरेंस बिटवीन ट्रेडिशनल प्रोग्रामिंग एंड मशीन लर्निंग Yeah, any replies? We do not need to program again. Yeah, somehow correct. We don't need to explicitly program. That will be more right. Job loss, machine learning makes the program based on output. Yeah, that's correct. Machine learning makes the program based on output. The feedback or behavior data acts as input. We hard code in traditional program. Machine learning is more logical. Okay, cool. So whatever I am asking you guys, you are somehow like answering it. So like, yeah, that's like, I'm very happy to see your responses. Just throughout the session, keep that going. So yeah, that's the difference between traditional programming and machine learning. ट्रेडिशनल प्रोग्रामिंग के केस में क्या होता है वी विल बी गिविंग द इनपुट वील बी राइटिंग द कोड एक्सप्लिसिटली एंड देन वील बी getting the output but what happens in case of machine learning is that we will be giving input we will be giving output and we will tell the machine you just go find the pattern between this input and output and tell us the program like I'm not going to code it by myself I'm just going to give you the input I'm just going you to give the output I'm not going to find the pattern it's your job machine that you need to find I will be giving you input and output So like yeah, so that's why this creation. For example, if I'm giving in traditional programming, if I'm giving inputs like 2 and 3, I will be writing the whole code for the addition of this inputs 2 and 3, and then I will be getting the output, which will be 5. But in case of machine learning, what I will be doing is I will be giving the inputs 2 and 3. I will also be giving the output 5. I will tell the machine, you find a pattern. You find a way or you find the logic behind how the inputs 2 and 3, how this inputs 2 and 3 will be related to our output 5. I guess it's pretty clear to all of you. Okay, so moving ahead, this is my favorite part. So I'm very sure while learning about all this, you must have come across this 4 terms, like ek machine learning here, dusra deep learning. एक आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस और एक डेटा साइंस सो कंफ्यूजिंग लाइक व्हेन आई फर्स्ट स्टार्टेड रीडिंग आई गॉट रियली कंफ्यूज्ड बिटवीन दिस फोर लाइक समहाउ किसी एक चीज बताओ तो दूसरा दूसरे से सिमिलर लगता ही है सो आई विल वॉन्ट यू गाइज टू रिप्लाई वॉट यू थिंक इज द डिफरेंस बिटवीन दिस फोर लाइक कुछ भी एनीथिंग विच यू थिंक ओके सो लेट मी चेक द रिप्लाइज I think थोड़ा टाइम लगेगा लाइक दिस इज अ लाइक लॉन्ग लॉन्ग टाइम आंसर होने वाला है सो या आई विल बी वेटिंग फॉर योर रिप्लाइज ML is okay we have one reply ML is only detect but AI will detect and act okay do we have some more replies किसी भी फील्ड का दूसरे फील्ड से डिफरेंस भी अगर पता है यू कैन जस्ट गो विद दैट ओके गाइज मशीन लर्निंग एंड डीप लर्निंग ओके नाइस ऑब्जर्वेशन Systems that get smarter and smarter over time without humans intervention is machine learning. Deep learning is a machine learning applied to large data set. Machine learning is supervised learning and DL is unsupervised.
See, like machine learning is
supervised learning and deep learning is unsupervised learning. We'll be getting into supervised and unsupervised later on within like 2 minutes. AI exhibits intelligence through decision making. ML allows system to learn from data from different levels to make the system smart. Okay, fine. We got some of the answers. So what I want to basically say, like you can already conclude from like seeing it. Machine learning, deep learning is basically a subset of machine learning. Machine learning is a subset of AI. And data science is like, it includes some of the features from all these three. And you can say AI is like very vast. It includes everything. Machine learning ho, deep learning ho, yeah, data science ho. Data science, when we talk about data science, it is more related to the business aspect. It is more related to taking insights from the structured and unstructured data. It is mostly used in like business applications mainly. Or if you talk about machine learning, it is mainly an algorithm which tries to improve its performance by getting experience from more and more data. And deep learning is also an algorithm, like the way machine learning is, and it also gets experience from data. But the difference is that deep learning is something which is inspired by the thinking of human brain, like which is inspired the structure and working of human brain, the way our human brain thinks. Usi ko hi use karke, they have gone to build something, neural networks, which is our concern of topic for tomorrow. And artificial intelligence, it is superset of all of this. That's like iske upar abhi bhi research chal raha hai, like it's being explored more and more. And AI is you can say it is more of a program that acts, resonates, or behaves like human. So if you want some example, I'm sure you must have watched the robot movie, the Chitti Robot over there. That can be an application of artificial intelligence. Or hamara Jarvis ko hi le lo, that is an application of artificial intelligence. The IPL match prediction, that is the application of data science. So yeah, pretty much it is. I know thoda bahut confusing lag raha hoga ye, but somehow this four fields have they are combined in a way. They share certain common features, and un sab ke applications bhi kind of concat kar jate hain. तुम बोल सकते हो. सो दैट्स सो इट्स ओके यू स्टेप आउट व्हाइल वी वर्क ऑन टुगेदर, व्हाइल वी गो ऑन वर्किंग ऑन सर्टेन प्रोजेक्ट्स, वी विल बी मच क्लियर अबाउट दिस. सो मूविंग अहेड, इफ आई एम ओके, सेशन के स्टार्टिंग में आई हैव ऑलरेडी टॉक्ड अबाउट दिस एप्लीकेशन ऑफ एमएल इन रियल वर्ल्ड. एंड या सो जस्ट लेट मी टेक यू टू अ साइट सो दैट you can kind of understand it better. Okay, let us visit this Amazon site. Okay, suppose I'm interested to buy laptop. Let us buy something over 50,000. Okay, suppose I'm interested. Okay, 3 lakh, थोड़ा सा ज्यादा हो गया. Okay, fine. If I'm interested to buy this one, suppose. Okay, so I'm scrolling down from like top to bottom. You guys tell me, what is the application of machine learning here? Like somehow मैंने थोड़ा सा hint दे दिया था session के starting में. I guess you guys can conclude or predict and tell me, like what's the application of machine learning in this site? Sorry, the price range is same. Okay, price range of what? Recommended products, yeah. The suggestions related to a customer who viewed this item, yeah, perfect. Yeah, buy it with. Yeah, you guys have already guessed it. Suggestion and comparing, yeah, perfect. Yeah, so machine learning is basically this is the application of machine learning. Like what they have done is this behind the site, they have implemented that machine learning algorithm and all, and they have kind of maintained a record of all their customers, and they have found that the person who bought this laptop along with it, they also bought these two things. So what it is doing, whenever the next person comes in, they give them a suggestion that buy all these things, then we'll be giving you a special discount. And compared with similar item, this is the market basket analysis That is the application of machine learning, and this compared with similar items, as one of you told that the price range is same. Yeah, they are like, you can see this is the price range 62,000, and this is an HP laptop. So what it is doing is it is comparing with similar other items. It is giving me all the HP examples and all those laptops whose price range is around 60,000. So like, it is giving me a recommendation. Like if I have choose this laptop, if I am thinking to buy this laptop, it is giving me all other recommendations which are in the same price range and which have the same characteristic. This is again the application of machine learning. So like you can see, we just opened a normal site and udhar aise hi dekhte dekhte do like application mil gaya machine learning ka. So and if I'm going to like, if I will be taking the whole day to explain the application of machine learning, then it will be short. That will also be short. So I won't be getting much into it because we need to proceed with our session. So yeah, about the bank I told, and all these are application of machine learning. You will be knowing about all this as we start working on this, like as you start working and researching on machine learning. So yeah, moving to the next slide. So yeah, I remember someone told that someone mentioned about supervised and unsupervised learning in the comment section recently. So these three are the types of machine learning, you can say. And reinforcement learning is something which we won't be getting into now, but just remember that it's an approach to AI, artificial intelligence ka ek approach hai, and either like the machines or it learns based on the reward and punishment wala concept. Like if it do something which is like good or which is our aim, then it gets reward, and if it like goes against that, it gets punishment. But we won't be getting deep into that for now, because our concern or our topic of concern for today is going to be supervised learning. And for that, you guys need to know the difference between supervised and unsupervised learning. So let me open my Jamboard. Okay, fine. So we are trying to know the difference between supervised and unsupervised learning. So what I'm trying to tell, if this is a circle, and let me see if there is a rectangle thing over here. Okay, I think I will have to draw it. Okay, fine. If this is a square, okay, so what happens in case of supervised learning is that this circle comes with a label that it's a circle. This image comes with a label that it's a circle. I know it's like isme like samjhana thoda muskil hai Jamboard mein, but yeah, bear with me. And this is square. So what happens in case of supervised learning is, let me write it down so that when I will be sharing it with you guys after the session is over, you guys can like thoda bahut kuch samajh mein aayega kya main explain karne ke try kar rahi thi. So yeah, what happens in case of supervised learning is that this figure comes with a label, this figure also comes with a label. So I will be giving my machine or my model this to a, that yeah, take this figure, it has a label known as circle, and take this figure, it has a label known as square. ML model. So when I will be giving a new figure, like again I will be giving something like this to this model, and I will be asking it out what it is, it can easily say me, yeah, you already have given me an example that something like this is circle, so this is a circle. So idhar basically humne use label de diya, to easily predict. Contrary to this, what happens in unsupervised learning is, Okay, so what happens in unsupervised learning is? Okay, square ka option hai idhar. This is not like looking like a circle perfectly, but yeah, okay, fine. Chal jayega. Square, this is the square, I guess. Yeah. Okay, fine. So we'll be giving our model this inputs. We have our ML model. We'll be giving this figures as input, and we'll be telling it we'll be just be giving this inputs, this figures as input. Like the earlier case, we won't be providing any like labels. So what our model will do is that it will like find this, start finding similarities between this all the six figures which I have given, and what it will find that this three similarity and this three also have similarity with each other. So what they will be doing is they will it will be finding the pattern, and it will be finding that ye teen ek dusre se similar hai and ye teen ek dusre se similar hai. So this is one category and this is another category. So based on that, it will be classifying without labels also. So that is basically the difference between supervised and unsupervised learning. And our topic of concern for today will be supervised learning. We'll be taking data with clearly defined output or with labels. So I guess samajh mein aaye. Can you give me a confirmation you understood whatever I told you till now? Yeah, okay, cool. Okay, so here comes the main part, the machine learning development lifecycle. So can you guys tell me machine learning development lifecycle ka matlab kya hai? You just see the figure and try to predict what I am trying to tell when I say machine learning development lifecycle. What do you think machine learning development lifecycle is? You can just see it once again. Lifecycle, development, machine learning. ये वर्ड्स को सेपरेटली इनका मीनिंग जो भी है उसको बस कंबाइन कर दो, यू विल बी गेटिंग इट. प्रोसेस ऑफ मेकिंग, या द प्रोसेस ऑफ मेकिंग ML मॉडल, या दैट्स इट. द ML मॉडल स्टेप्स टू क्रिएट अ मशीन लर्निंग मॉडल एंड डिप्लॉय इट, या परफेक्ट. So as you already told, these are the steps or the guidelines we need to follow while building a machine learning model. So first of all, data we need to collect, data data collections ka data which we will be feeding to our machine learning model. It is not as simple as that jo maine square le liya, circle le liya, usko fit kar diya, bol do ki difference kya hai. That was just an example. Basically the data which will be providing to our model will not be as simple as that. For today, if you are asking about today, we are going to work on a CSV file, that is the comma separated file, jisme kya rows columns ke form mein hota hai data. We'll be feeding that to our model. And but if you are going to talk about the real life application, data collection ke aur bhi other ways hote hai, wo API se hota hai, web scraping karke bhi kar sakte hain, but we are not going to know about all that now. What we'll be doing is we'll be taking a CSV file. Usme hamare details rows and columns ke form mein honge. We'll be using that for our data purpose. Okay, after data retrieval is done, the next step is data preparation. So data preparation is we'll be hamara jo rows and columns ke form mein data hota hai, it can be we can't fit that directly to our model. So it needs to be kind of processed before we can give it to our machine learning algorithm, so that then only it will be able to kind of utilize that algorithm or work upon it. We need to process it so that our performance of our model will be better. So we need to carry certain steps, and that steps comes in data preparation, like we prepare it before we send it for modeling purposes. So mainly three processes hota hai, data processing, feature extraction and engineering, feature scaling and selection. So we will be like understanding in details about each of the three steps. We'll also be taking a CSV file, and we'll be carrying out all the steps. Like from the scratch, we'll be taking a CSV file, we'll be carrying all the steps. Then we'll be fitting a machine learning algorithm, and we'll be building our machine learning model. And but before that, I just want to give you a brief idea. Data processing consists of, we'll be knowing about that. This involves mainly removing the null values. Feature engineering is like that consists of a large number of steps. So I won't be telling you like right now. We will be getting to know about that in just, you can say, 1 hour. Okay, feature scaling and selection, we have a CSV file. It has some rows and columns, and we can give all the features to the model, but we will have to be selective about the features we are giving, or selective about the columns we are giving. And then this is the main part. This is our machine learning algorithm, which we fitted to our model. We'll be giving the prepared data and the algorithm, that is the machine learning algorithm, to our model. Then we'll be evaluating the performance of our model. And if we find that the performance is not up to the mark, it is not satisfactory, what we'll be doing is we will be going back again to this data preparation step. So like you can take the real life example of making tea. So tea banane ke liye kya kya chahiye? What is a CSV file? That's a comma separated file. We'll be getting into that. You don't need to worry. Like thoda agar like kuch samajh mein nahi aaya hoga, don't worry. Just be with us till the end. We'll be clearing all your doubts one by one. That's comma separated file. Let me see if I can show you. ये माइक्रोसॉफ्ट एक्सेल कॉमा सेपरेटेड वैल्यूज फाइल यू कैन सी राइट दैट इज व्हाट आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट इट्स ओपनिंग इट इज शिट आई क्लोज्ड इट आई गेस अगेन लेट मी ओपन इट अगेन Yeah, so this one is a comma separated file. What we'll be doing, it's taking some time to load. Okay, fine. What we'll be doing is we'll be giving this comma separated file. Isme jo bhi, it's not opening. Oh, yeah, this one. Okay, fine. So this is a comma separated file. Isme jo ye तुम देख रहे होगे, दिस आर द हॉरिजॉन्टल आर द रोज एंड दिस वर्टिकल आर द कॉलम्स एंड दिस इज व्हाट इज द डेटा फॉर अस फॉर टुडे इन दैट विल बी फीडिंग टू आवर मॉडल एंड आई नो थोड़ा बहुत कंफ्यूजिंग लगा होगा बिकॉज आई जस्ट टोल्ड यू द नेम्स ऑफ द आई जस्ट काइंड ऑफ टोल्ड यू द नेम्स एंड देन लक्ष्मण विल बी एक्सप्लेनिंग यू लाइक व्हाट्स द नीड ऑफ दिस डेटा प्रिपरेशन पार्ट एंड द मॉडलिंग पार्ट And after that, we'll be moving to the coding part. Like I will be telling you how we can carry these steps through Python code. Okay, so what? Back to the question, like I asked, what ingredients you need for making tea? It's needed for our like discussion. So like I'm just not essay randomly maine pooch nahi liya, but you guys can reply what ingredients you need to gather while making tea. Water, okay. Milk, tea, sugar, yes. Let me ask my mom, okay, coffee. Okay, fine. You don't need to ask your mom. You can just see the comment sections to know the answers. Okay, fine. So while making tea, we need to have ingredients like tea leaves, sugar and milk. So you can think you are bringing those sugar and milk as the ingredients. You are यू आर ब्रिंगिंग इट फ्रॉम लाइक तुम अपने ग्रोसरी शॉप से लाओ या फिर घर में ही है उधर से लेके आओ, दैट इज यू कैन कंसीडर एज डेटा रिट्रीवल. एंड देन वंस यू आर गैदरिंग दिस इंग्रेडिएंट्स यू विल बी देन काइंड ऑफ यू कैन से दिस गैदरिंग लाइक द गैदरिंग स्टेप और द कलेक्शन ऑफ दोज इंग्रेडिएंट्स इज समथिंग विच विल गो इन डेटा प्रिपरेशन. यू कैन प्लेसिंग ऑल द इंग्रेडिएंट्स इन अ कंटेनर. सो that's what happens in data preparation, you can say. Then machine learning algorithm, you will be placing all these ingredients in a container, and to make the tea you need to provide flame to it, na. So you can think of this flame as the machine learning algorithm. And then when you jab tum ye sab kya gas mein ye sab bitha dete ho, and then finally you get something which is your tea, and that process of making tea, you can say it's modeling. And finally, you serve it in a, like, you serve it and you test it. That comes in the model evaluation part. And you come to know that, like, you need to add more sugar. So that in the evaluation process, you found that you added bit of less sugar. So you need to add more sugar. So you go back and to this data preparation part, you go and add some more sugar to it. So, yeah, like, I just wanted to make a comparison so that you could better understand it, so that you could better understand it and remember it using this tea analogy. So I guess it's clear for now, whatever I have discussed till now, because now Lakshman will be taking over the session. He will be mainly explaining you about the machine learning algorithm, the maths and the statistics behind this modeling part, and the need of this data preparation part. Because whenever we talk about machine learning, we just don't talk about this, the algorithm we'll be using. We'll not just talk about the machine learning model we'll be building. We'll not just be talking about the evaluation part. Rather, we will always be taking into consideration this data preparation part and this data retrieval part. Because whenever you are building a machine learning project or you're working on a machine learning pipeline, you can say this is something. So yeah, Lakshman will be taking over the session now, and he will be explaining you the need of data preparation and the need of this the statistics and maths behind this machine learning model. I guess that will take near about 20 to 30 minutes, and after that we will be back again to our main question, that is we'll be going through the codes. We'll be going through our Python codes to understand. All these processes, like how it's actually done using code. So yeah. Okay, fine. Are you guys having any doubt till now? Or no? Okay, cool. So let me stop sharing. Lakshman, are you there?
Yes, yes.
Okay, fine. You can take over the session now.
Yeah. So till now, Priyanka has explained you the what is machine learning and what is the applications of machine learning, and by showing the Amazon website example, which is a recommender system, they try to explain you what is supervised learning and unsupervised learning, the difference between both of them, and machine learning life cycle. But so till now we have covered this. So what's the plan for next? So you can think yourself that what is the need of this machine learning? Why someone try to develop this machine learning? And you all have replied that machine learning is just like human brains. So if there is human brain already present, then what is the why we need to make another computer based models which can work like just like humans? What is the need of actual machine learning, and how this machine learning actually work in our computer system? That's we're gonna talk further, right? So let me share my screen first. So uh, First, we're going to tackle why machine learning. As you all have said that machine learning is just like clone of human brain. So why we need to make this another model called machine learning? And by this example, you're going to know by yourself what is the actual meaning of machine learning. So first of all, let's differentiate between a human brain and a computers. So let me ask you a question. Like 10 into 20 is how much? So a normal human person quickly say that it is 20, and 20 into 20 is how much? It's 40, right? But what if may I ask you, 165 into 165.7? I know you all can say the answer perfectly, but it's take you some time, right, to say the answer. You can't say the answer quickly, like you have said 10 into 2 is equal to 20. You have to take some time to say this answer. But if I ask a calculator instead of you, then they can say the answer very rightly, perfectly, and very fastly. So that is one of the difference between human and a computer. Like computers can fastly calculate. Actually, you can say that humans are poor in mathematics. Computers can very fastly calculate the mathematical concepts. And another difference between human and machines is that computers have their own limitations. Like if there are some data are present in computer, and if I ask you some other questions, like if you search in search bar, like in Amazon website, if you search some product like a bag, and if there is no bag is not present, then they only show you the bag is not present. But instead of searching in a Google, if you ask in a retail store, then they not only told you that bag is not present, they obviously told you that bag will arrive soon, or anything, some extra point they definitely told you. But what I want to explain in point is that computers have their own limitations. Like human can think and came to a conclusion, but computers can't think beyond their limitations. But humans are known for that's make us different from the animals. Like we can think beyond our limitations, so that's make us human. But computers can't think beyond their limitations. Like they can't perform any other works beyond their data sets. So these are the two main difference. But some of the scientists saw this difference and came into thought that if we mix both of them, then our calculation must be fast, and our thinking of limitation must be मतलब दोनों में जो deficiency है वो मतलब full हो जाएगा. तो उन लोगों ने क्या सोचा, they can't provide the human capability to calculate very fastly. So what they think that they can provide some intelligence to computers, so that they can think like humans, like they can think beyond their limitations. So that may be possible, right? We cannot make humans to calculate so fastly. But there are some persons who can calculate it very fastly, no doubt. But we can. But they came into thought that if we can transfer our intelligence to the computer, then our job is done, right? So that's where the machine learning came into the market. You must be understand that what is the need of machine learning and how the concept of making this. Machine learning concept thought into the mind or come into the market, and by now you can understand the meaning of machine learning by its name perfectly. So that is the need of machine learning, and this is how built. But does machine learning, we can provide the complete human brains to the machine computers? We even don't know how the human brains work actually properly. So what they used behind this, to provide the intelligence to machine learning? Obviously, mathematics. Mathematics is always true, right? Mathematics. They use the some standard mathematical concepts or some standard mathematical tools to provide this intelligence to a computer. So we're going to discuss that part actually. So how this machine learning, how this mathematical concept actually work to provide a capability to the computer that they can think beyond their limitations. So that's our point of motto today, right? So before jumping to the mathematics behind, mathematics behind machine learning, let me go through an examples, right? Let's think you are a team of 2 to 3 persons and you are assigned a work, like you have to go to some XYZ university and collect some data of their students, like just take a simple data, right? First, how many hours some the students study per day and how much marks they got in the exam, right? So this is the simple data you have to collect from the some XYZ university. So somewhat they collected like this: if a student studied 2 hours, they got 20% mark. This is just dummy data, right, guys? If someone studied 3 hours, then he got 30% marks. And for 4 hours, 40%, and for 7 hours, it's 70%. So if I ask you, after collecting all this data, let's say they collected this much of data from the they collected this data from the university, and after collecting this data, if I ask you, if someone studies 6 hours, then how much mark he get in the exam? You can write it on the chat box. Yeah, 60%. That is cool, right? So how you know that it's 60? How you know that this is 60? Obviously, you have you've seen that a pattern here. Every time we multiply 10 with the input and we get the output is. So how this is actually normal numbers. So you came to know that very easily. It is 60. Right, but how this actually works I tend to explain it through a graph. This is hour axis and this is marks axis. For you have collected this much data, right? So for 2 hours it's 20, for 3 hours it is 30, for 4 hours it is 40. So if I connect all these points and then ask they connected all this point and then give the input 6 into it, like 6, and get the output against mark success, and obviously it's 60. So this is how they came to find out like how much marks you get in the exam. So you have already studied in your 11th, right? This is called slope, and here it is 10. So what's the formula we used here? Y is equal to mx plus c, right? This is the formula. Here c is 0, and m is slope, right? So let me think a situation like that. If you collected this much of data and created a model like this, right? And this is for student number one, this is for student number two, this is for student number three, and this is for student number four. And after collecting all this data, another student came out and asked you, if I study 8.1 hour per day, then how much mark I will get? You don't have the data for this, right? For 8.1 hour, you haven't collected data from the university, how much marks you will get. But there is some pattern, right? From this data, you got a pattern, right? From that pattern, you can predict for 8.1 hour. You easily calculated that it is 81% you will get in the marks. 81% marks you will get in the exam. And that is right. So our machine learning model also works in this way. This formula, y is equal to mx plus c, this is the building block of the machine learning concept. You know, everywhere, in higher concepts, CNN, RNN, all this concept, the basic building block of this formula is this formula, y is equal to mx plus c. By this formula, you can predict the, we haven't collected the data for 8.1 hour, but we can able to predict the output by using the formula y is equal to mx plus 3, by using this pattern. So our main motto is to creating a model is to finding this pattern. So by using this pattern, if you don't have the enough data or you have some missing data, so you can fill that data by using this pattern or by using this formula. This is the actual standard starting of the machine learning came into the market. So you have studied in your 11th, this is formula y is equal to mx plus c. But in machine learning concept, this formula is somewhat different. That is y is equal to wx plus b. Here b is called bias and w is called weight. And here this b or this c is not always zero. Like if a student studies 0 hour per day, so definitely you will not get 0 marks in that. You will get 5 to 10% of the marks, right? So in that case, the c value of c becomes 5 or 10, etc., etc. So this is the actual standard formula behind creating a machine learning model, right? So let me open a new tab. So let's jump to deep into it. Just so let's say your team, if your team go into this XYZ university, they haven't collected only the hour of study, number of hours student studies per day. They collected some other data, right? They can also like how hours the studies per week, and what is his name, how much time he spent in the cafeteria, and what is the percentage of attendance, what is his parents' name, and how much marks he get in the exam. So our machine learning, you may understand till now that our main motto of the machine learning is that we collected some data from some source, and based on that data, we have to predict some predict something that is not available in our data. That is the main motto of the machine learning, right? Till now, that is the main motto of our machine learning. So this much data they collected, and what is parents' name, cafeteria mein kitna time bitata hai, wo sab wo log collect kar le. So they found some data like this, and marks, right? So to predicting how much marks he get in the exam, couldn't you see that his name doesn't affect the, actually this all these columns are called features in machine learning concept. All these concepts are actually called as features. As this hour, this name, this cafeteria, this all are one feature, and marks is also one feature. This is called a targeted value, what you have to predict. That is called targeted value. So you can think that this name doesn't affect the marks, right? His name doesn't affect the marks, and after collecting all this data, the thought that this name doesn't affect his marks, his parents' name doesn't affect his marks, his roll number doesn't affect the marks, right? So this all this data doesn't affect the marks, and if they calculated some of the data from the university, and for a student like for some student, they couldn't able to get how much hour they studies per day, but they able to get his name, cafeteria, time spent in the cafeteria, percentage attendance, assignment submission, etc. they collected, and some of the data they can't able to submit, right? So by if the data is not present there, so how can we able to predict the how much marks you will get in the exam, right? if the data is missing. Some of the data are present there, but if a single feature's data is missing, then that may affect the our accuracy of our model to predicting the marks. Let's say he spent some time in cafeteria. Based on that, you predicted that he will not get much mark. But what if he studies 10 hours per day, but this data is not missing? So that may be incorrect. So the basic point here I want to say is that after collecting all this data, we have to work on this data, right? So we have to find which data directly affect the marks column, right? Our targeted output columns. Like here, name doesn't affect. So we don't need this name column in our final data set. We have to remove this data. And for this parents' name doesn't affect his marks, right? So, and his roll number doesn't affect his mark for predicting his mark. So we have to neglect all this data. And roll number, we have to remove all this data from our final data set. And if some of the point is the null points are there, then we have to fill this data with some value. I don't know how you fill this. You have to collect the data from particular student or any. There are so many other concepts, like you can fill this data. You have to fill the data, but the final data set would be like that. Only those columns or those features should be present there, who directly affect our targeted outputs, right? So number of hours studies in the per day will directly affect his mark. Cafeteria time in the cafeteria, his percentage attendance will definitely affect his mark. So the point is, you have to choose only those features which directly affect the data, and rest of that you have to neglect all that data points, right? So this part is called data preprocessing. So all the real world data you find in the market or you collected, those are present in the form that some of the data directly affecting the marks, some of the data doesn't affecting the marks. So there are some null points. You have to standardize all this and make in a format that all these final features columns that should be present, that would be directly affecting this mark. So that's so you can now you have understand that why this data pre-processing is most important before creating. So we have to create a model. Right? So before creating a model, this data pre-processing part is most important. Yeah, I think you understand this part. just clear me if you understand or not. Give me a quick reply. Have you understand why this data preprocessing part is important? So let's jump into the next part, right? So till now we understood why this data preprocessing is important. So we told you previously this prediction is based on our pattern. We have to make a pattern. Based on that pattern, we can able to predict the future values, right? Those values are not present there while collecting this data, right? So let me think of an example. Like you understand what is features, right? Let's x1 is a feature, x2 is a feature, x3 is a feature, x4 is a feature, and y is targeted output. This all x1, x2, x3, x4 directly affecting the targeted output, guys. In the real in standard machine learning model, there are millions numbers of features, right? So you have to tackle, you're going to understand that tomorrow, guys. In deep learning part, you better understand this part. There are millions number of features in real data set or in standard mathematical standard machine learning models. But as of now, you can think of there are only four features there, and you have one targeted output, right? Only targeted output is always on. So you have some data, right? This data. So now we're trying to understand how actually this machine learning model actually work. So all this data, you have pre-processed the data and this is our final data set. So before creating the model, you have to split this data into two parts, right? Split this data into two parts. This is called train part and this is called test part. That may be of ratio 80 to 20 ratio, you can split the data. And you have all these values, right? You have all these values. So what happened? First of all, you created a model and put this model. While creating a model, what happened is, you know the formula I already explained you, y is equal to wx plus b, right? So that is for only one feature. That I have, there I have taken x is hours only, but here there are more than one x. So formula would be like y is equal to w1 x1 plus w2 x2 plus w3 x3 plus b w4 x4 plus b. This formula we're going to use here. So by using this formula, how can we make a pattern? Or pattern, this actually machine learning model, how they make a pattern. So first, this is the our first data points, right? This has some value x1 x2 x3 x4 and y. So while starting this model, they automatically get a value of w1 w2 w3 or w4 and satisfy the formula, right? And b, the from initially they take some random value of w1 w2 w3 w4 b and satisfy the equation. So for the first document, they choose a random value of w1 w2 w3 w4 and b and store it as reference, right? W1 w2 w3 W4 and B, store this all this value into a reference, and then our model jump into the next document, that is document number 2, and put this reference W1 W2 W3 W4 and B into all this data point. Multiply X1 with W1 previous W1 and multiply this X2 with W2, X3 with W3, X4 with W4 and add B and find a new value of Y1, right? And you have the original value of y and check its closeness against this value, and if the value is close, then that fixed the w1 w2 w3 w4 and b, and it is not closer to y, then that change the value of w1 w3 w4 w4 such that by the second step that changes the w1 w2 w3 w4 and store that value for reference again, and that reference value should be like that they are both satisfying these two data points, right? In the second reference of this weight and bias should satisfy this both value. They choose that type of weight and bias and jump into the third statement, and again they check the measurements again original y, and if the changes is required then change. The changes should be reflected on all these data points, and in the final and in this repeated step, they finally come into a standard reference value of this W1, W2, W3, W4, and B. This W1, W4, W3, W4, and B satisfy all this train data point. 80% of the data satisfy this equation. Like if you put the all the data with this formula, then you got exact like closer value of their original targeted output, and they store it as reference, and this is the end of the creating the complete machine learning model, and this is the final value they got and created the model. So you now say that only the train data point is used for creating the model, right? So what is the use of this test data point? The already we have splitted this and store it in test part, right? 20% our data, and then we check that this all value satisfies this train data only. So we don't know if all the standard reference weight and bias should satisfy the test data or not. Then we check this all this value, all this W1, W2, W3, W4 and B against test data again. We multiply the X1, X2, X3, X4 with W1, W2, W3, and add B and find the Y1 and check its original value against test Y of test data. And from there, we can conclude that our accuracy. If we get better accuracy, then we say that our model is perfect. And our model is perfect. And if we get better accuracy, like 80% to 90%, like that, then we can say that this is our model. So what is the meaning of creating a model? Creating a model means finding the value of this W1, W2, W3, W4, and B. So now, from all the collected data, you created a model. Now, some students come into you whose data is not present in your data set, and he said, I studied this much time per day, and I spent this much time in cafeteria, my percentage is this much, and etc. So what could be my marks? Then you simply do that, and this is let X1, X2, X3, X4. They said you that my X1 is this, my X2 is this, my X3 is this, my X4 is this, and what would be my marks, right? So then you can easily predict by using the formula Y is equal to W1 X1 plus W2 X2 plus W3 X3 plus W4 X4 plus B. We have standard value of W1 which satisfy for all the students. Like we find out these values of W1, W2 by analyzing millions number of students. That depends on our data set actually. If our length of our data set is million, then we find out this value from million references. So there is a probability that we are nearest to the correct answer, right? We can predict very correctly that how much marks you get in the exam. This is actually how machine learning model actually works. So this is actual mathematical concept behind the machine learning. So let me open another tab. So there is not only the cases of finding how much marks I get. The marks may be anything, 0%, 20%, 30%, 31%, etc. Right? By using the above formula, you can find a linear line, continuous value. Like, and this type of problem is called regression type. That is continuous type. We can get the only continuous values from a range, right? So that is not the case always. What if some students come into you and give you the features like X1, X2, X3, and X4, and ask you, what do you think? If I fail in the exam or pass in the exam? So in that case, that is the cases of classification, right? So there is only two probability: either he will fail or he will pass. So how could you predict that if he will pass or fail? We only know the X1, X2, X3, X4, and we find out how much marks he get in the exam. So by using this regression concept, we can able to predict the classification concept. We can able to solve the classification problem also, right? So what is the case? let's say this is all the point, like two get 20% marks, three get 30% marks, and etc. From this y is equal to W1 X1 plus W2 X2, we got this score, right? This is also a straight line. So let's say we got this score. So if we put a boundary condition here that for 33%, right? If some student got marked more than 33%, then he will pass in the exam. And if some student got less than 33%, then he will fail in the exam. So by using this then the student came into you and give this x1, x2, x3, x4, and you find his marks, and by using this boundary condition, you can able to predict either he will pass in the exam or fail in the exam. So this actually works for regression concept. We use this linear straight line formula, but for this classification, we have used some other mathematical concept called sigmoid function. That is 1 divided by 1 plus e to the power minus y. This y gives you continuous value, and this ranges from 0 to 1, and we put the boundary condition 0.5. If it is more than including 0.5, then it is pass or some other, and for less it is fail. By this way, you can able to classify the you can able to solve the classification problems also. So this is all about the mathematics behind the machine learning model. So I hope you have understood what is the necessity of this data preprocessing part and how this machine learning model actually works. What is the mathematical concept behind? Actually, there is no concept like human brain. It's only pure mathematics. So by using some standard, this type of standard mathematics, we can able to predict the future values, right? So till now, if you have any doubts, then you can ask me, right? I think no doubt. Then next we'll jump into the coding part with a example. Priyanka, are you there?
I'm there. Okay, fine. So I'm sure you must have been bored of the mathematics things, but yeah, it's kind of necessary to understand the mathematics behind the working of our machine learning model, because need to know it before you start the data preparation part. It was highly essential for you all to understand the intuition behind that and the need of data preparation. So now we'll be jumping to the most interesting part and the most awaited part of today's session, that is the coding. So can you guys give me can you guys tell me, are you excited to move to the coding part or not? Like, so some energy, how much excited you are, so that we'll just be like, abhi tak jo bhi humne padha, that was all theoretical part. Initially we just learned some theory applications and all that, then we came to the mathematics, and finally we'll be moving to coding, to the coding part. But before that, let me share some blogs to you, so that what I want is that you should be saving this links. Yeah, so you guys can save this link, and after the session is over, I will advise you that you should go through this. Like, you will be getting whatever you understood till now, uska thoda bahut idea aur better way se mil jayega about that mathematical part and that sigmoid thing. So it will be pretty much helpful. So you guys can save this link. So you guys go on and save this link. And yes, yeah, Python is involved. We'll be coding using Python only. Machine learning mainly Python industry mein Python are used kiya jata hai, and Python is more famous for us students. So we'll be coding using Python. So you guys can save this link. I guess you all have saved this link, and yes, please refer to it after the session is over. So yeah, we won't be taking much time, and we will just be jumping to the coding part. Let me share my screen first. Okay, before that, can you guys tell me how many of you already know Python? Simple Python kisko aata hai? Kuch bhi, thoda bahut sikha hai Python basics. Okay, so it will be better for me to, is there anyone who doesn't know Python? थोड़ा बहुत मी ओके यू ओके फाइन इट्स ओके. Even if you don't know Python, what we'll be doing is I will be while running each and every code, I will be trying to explain you the like what's that, what does that code mean? Okay, cool. That's not an issue. We'll be like starting from the scratch, and I'm sure you will be able to understand it. And if any doubt arises, the chat section is all yours. And you can also contact us after the session is over with your doubts. We'll be more than happy to help you out. Okay, till bubble sort, yeah, you know sufficient again, I can say, to understand this session. Okay, fine. I guess my screen is visible. So what we will be doing, we'll be using Google Co Colab for implementing our code. I guess you all must be acquainted with Google Colab, but still, is there anyone who is not acquainted with Google Colab? Okay, fine. Let me tell you guys what is Google Colab. So this is it. You can just go to your Google and search Google Colab over there, and so this is what our Google Colab looks like. If you search Google Colab over here, we don't have enough time to go through all of this, but in your free time you can go through all this. Colab is basically, you can it allows you to write and execute Python in your browser without downloading or installing any other software. And you can see, it's already mentioned over here. Data science is also mentioned over here. So yeah, basically it allows you to write your code and execute your code in Python in your browser, and you don't need to install any other software and all. So yeah, it's pretty much helpful. So this is also the Colab file which we will be using today in our session. So let me do one thing. Okay, we'll be jumping. I will be sharing this notebook with you all, so that while I will be discussing all this, you can simultaneously go through the code with me. So yeah, we'll be so here we are using one of the applications. We'll be utilizing machine learning. अब तक हमने मशीन लर्निंग का थ्योरी पढ़ लिया. नाउ वी विल बी यूटिलाइजिंग द मशीन लर्निंग, वॉट एवर वी लर्न, वॉट एवर लक्ष्मण एक्सप्लेन, लाइक द मैथमेटिकल पार्ट अबाउट द वेट एंड बायस कॉन्सेप्ट, अबाउट द फीचर सिलेक्शन, अबाउट द डेटा प्रिपरेशन पार्ट. ऑल दैट वो सुनने में इतना इंटरेस्टिंग नहीं लग रहा होगा, बट ट्रस्ट मी, व्हेन यू अप्लाई इट यूजिंग कोड्स, इट इज लाइक इट्स डैम इंटरेस्टिंग. सो लेट्स मूव हियर. सो व्हाट वी विल बी ट्राइंग टू डू इज, वी विल बी टेकिंग अ लाइक डे टू डे यूज केस. विल बी टेकिंग इनटू कंसीडरेशन द एप्लीकेशन ऑफ डेटा साइंस इन द कमर्शियल सेक्टर. सो will be mainly trying to find out the bank churn prediction rate. So now you must be like, what the hell, what is this churn? Churn means, and bank churn prediction क्या होता है? तो basically churn prediction, it is one of the most important applications of data science in the commercial sector. Churn is mainly defined like we all have subscription to Netflix and Spotify and all that, right? सो वेन एवर एनी वन ऑफ अस कैंसल्स द सब्सक्रिप्शन, और बस सब्सक्रिप्शन की बात नहीं है, वेन एवर यू आर गोइंग टू अ बैंक, और वेन तुम किसी भी सर्विस के अगर कस्टमर हो एंड यू कैंसल दैट सब्सक्रिप्शन, दैट इज वेन द चर्न अकर्स. ओके, सो वी आर टेकिंग इन टू कॉन्सिडरेशन द बैंक चर्न प्रेडिक्शन. सो कैन यू गाइस टेल मी, ये चर्न प्रेडिक्ट करना, कौन कौन से कस्टमर्स चर्न प्रेडिक्शन में, यानी कि विल बी बेसिकली ट्राइंग टू प्रेडिक्ट कौन से कस्टमर्स का चर्न करने के चांसेस ज्यादा है, कौन से कस्टमर्स का सर्विस को लीव करने के चांसेस ज्यादा है. सो कैन यू गाइस टेल मी हाउ दिस चर्न प्रेडिक्शन इज यूजफुल टू एनी ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, एनी केसेस? आई एम वेटिंग फॉर योर रिप्लाई. यू गाइस टू इम्प्रूव रिटेंशन, या दैट्स द आंसर आई नीडेड. Okay, we have got just one answer till now. It's correct though, but I'm expecting ticket booking. Okay. Ticket booking, churn prediction, telecom sector. Yeah, it's used in telecom sector to focus on a set of customers. Yeah, perfect. So yeah, churn prediction, as I have already told you, like if we are in an organization, what we'll be doing, we will be more than investing our energy and money in bringing new customers, why not we should invest our energy in retaining the old customers? That will be a little less expensive, right? So what the customer, what they are doing is, what the bank is doing, bank or any other organization, you can say what they are doing. They have collected a set of records of their previous customers, all their informations. Okay, fine. So this is serial number. So these are all the customers, you can say, and all these are the columns, like all of the information, their name, whether they have credit card or not, and such sort of information, and whether they are continuing their service in the bank or they left. Suppose this person is continuing the service. So this person has exited the bank services. So suppose it's one. Here one means he has exited the bank services. He has left the bank service, and zero means he is still in continuation with the service. And two, suppose this person is like in service. So what I will be doing as an organization, what we will be doing is we will be analyzing this data and we'll be applying it on a new set of customers. Whenever a new customer joins, uska information bhi hume mil gaya hoga. So what we will do in advance, we will try to predict what are the chances of this customer's leaving. And if I find that this XYZ person, based on this previous information, iska features jo hai, is person ke sath matching hai. So this serial number one person is kept matching, and he has the chances of leaving the bank service. So what I will be doing, I will be providing him certain offers, like, yeah, if you stay with this bank, we'll be providing this interest, that interest. So yeah, that's how they the banks and all other how they provide us with offers. If you have marked all other telecom sector also, as soon as you plan on leaving their services, they provide you more and more offers. So yeah, they just try which of the customer is going to churn out, and they provide them certain offers, and that's the way they maximize profit. So we have taken one of the data set of that is bank churn prediction. Here we will be trying to find out based on the previous set. We'll be provided a data set. We'll be trying to analyze the pattern. We'll be fitting all the details into our machine learning model, so that whenever we provide some new data to our machine learning model, it can tell us whether that customer is going to stay in the bank or he is going to leave. So this is my notebook. Let me check if I can share it with you guys so that you can run it simultaneously. Okay, I'm only giving you the Wing SS. You can only view the codes, you can change the codes, but yeah, you can run with me. So yeah, I'm pasting it over here. So you guys understood about that, the application of the bank churn prediction I told you till now, or you guys have any doubt? If anyone is having any doubt, you can just tell us without thinking or without worrying about anything. Yeah, you can also create a copy of your own file. Yeah, what you can do is, let me just show you. You will be opening this link. You'll be going to this link. It will open basically that the file I have shared with you guys. And you won't be able to do some changes to it. So what you can you will be able to only run the cells. So what you can do is, you can go to this file option, and there you can select on this save a copy in Drive, and a new tab will be opened, which will be named as copy of this day one bank churn modeling and all. So yeah, you can do any either of the ways. So can we proceed further? You guys are not having any doubt, I assume. Can you give me a confirmation if we could proceed further or not? Okay, cool. So yeah, this is our Google Collab and we'll be working on this. If you can see, you know, you need to, like, here we have mentioned about, like, you can click here to go to the data set. So you guys can open your notebook. Udhar jo bhi hoga, you can also click over there and download the data set. And basically, this is the CSV file, that the comma separated file that I mentioned about, we will be working on. So you can basically download it. Okay, I have already downloaded it. So yeah, you can download it. You guys can download it. If you want, you can go through the notebook, and I will also be providing you the link of the Kaggle site so that you can easily access it. Let me give it in the chat box. Yeah, you can also download the data set from here. So let's get started. So basically we'll be, so this is the table of contents. Basically machine learning development lifecycle mein maine jo jo features bataye the, jo jo steps bataye the, we will only be carrying out that using codes. So can you guys tell me machine learning development lifecycle mein kya kya process the, if anyone remembers? Like I showed you this machine learning development lifecycle, right? Just a few minutes ago. Okay, fine. Usme kya kya steps the? You guys must have seen it already. Go on and write that in your in the chat box. Jo bhi steps the. Okay, yeah, I watched Ben 10. I know you must have seen this one here. Okay, data retrieval. Data processing, train model, data collection, processing, modeling, deployment. Yeah, cool. So we'll be carrying out all those steps in our using our code. So first of all, to carry out all the steps, you need to import certain libraries. So these are the libraries we'll be needing in our code. So there are certain libraries known as NumPy, Pandas, Matplotlib, Seaborn. You guys need to time will not be permitting us to go in depth about all these four things, that is Seaborn, Matplotlib, NumPy, Pandas. But whenever you get into machine learning, you guys need to be clear about this, because you will be coming in contact with this more often. Like NumPy is used for implementing multidimensional array and matrices. Matplotlib and Seaborn, we will be plotting graphs, and we'll be plotting the bar plots, the bar graphs, the histogram that we have studied in our 8th class maths, I guess. And similarly, Pandas is used for data manipulation and analysis. You just guys know now the use of this libraries. Once the session is over, you guys can watch videos on this. I'm just mentioning it in the chat so that you guys need to be clear about this four topics. So you can later on Google about this or refer tutorials regarding this. So yeah, so we'll be importing these libraries, and all these libraries, these are all required. We'll be using all that later on in our course. So when the need for this will be arising, I will be explaining about the rest of the libraries. So
increase font size, please.
Sorry for that. Is it visit? Okay, sorry. Yeah. Is it all right now?
125%.
I guess this will work. Okay, fine. You guys, can you guys give me confirmation whether the the codes are visible to you or not? Okay, fine. Okay, so. So while working on this, you guys must have downloaded the CSV file. So you need to load it over here, so that load it over to your notebook so that we can gather data from here. So you need to click on this icon and then go to this upload option. Mostly it's, since you downloaded it, it will be in the download folder, I guess. Yeah. This one. So you can upload it like the way I did. So yeah, it's already uploaded. So let's proceed further. So you can run the cell by like clicking over here. And once the cell is executed, you'll be seeing the screen tick wala symbol over here. So okay, yeah, once we import the libraries, the next most important step is importing the data. And we'll be I have already showed you the CSV file, right? This is the CSV file. And before fitting it to our model, before giving this as input to our model, what we need to do is we need to analyze it. So for that analysis purpose, we have created a variable named as df using that PD here. We are using here, whenever NumPy will be occurring, we'll be using NumPy, matplotlib will be occurring, we'll be using PLT. So whenever pandas will be occurring, we'll be using PD. So this is a simple Python code for reading whatever is written in this CSV file and storing it in a variable df. So df is basically a variable, and we are storing all the information of that is in this CSV file. All this information, that is this rows and column information, which is present in the CSV file, we are storing it into df, which is our variable. So next, moving to the data information part. Data information, here we try to analyze our data. Before feeding it to the model, we need to kind of understand our data so that we could deal with it in a much better way. So yeah, so this is df.safe. Pata hi chal jaraoga safe, safe is, so it tells us about the dimension of our data, that is 10,000, 14. It gives me 10,000, 14 when I run df.safe. So can you guys tell me what is 10,000 over here and 14 over here? What is 10,000 and 14 over here? When I do df.safe, I get 10,014 rows and columns. Yeah, exactly. This rows. So when I do df.save, I stored all this information in my in the df variable. So when I'm doing df.save, it's giving me 10,004. So it has 10,000 rows. This CSV file has 10,000 rows and 14 columns. So when we click on df.columns, this is giving me all the list of 14 columns. These are the list of 14 columns, that is row number, customer ID, surname, credit score, geography, gender, age, and all that. Okay, fine. When I do df.head, it's actually, let me show the default one again, first of all. So yeah. Next is df.head. When I press df.head, what do you think this is doing? Any guesses? I don't know. Top rows and columns, top five. Yeah. So basically what it is doing is, when I do df.head, by default, it is giving me the first five rows, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And so all this first five rows it is giving me. And if you're already into coding, you must be knowing for us the number or the counting never starts from one, it always starts from zero. So yeah, it's 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, but it's 5, these are the 5 rows. By default, it's 5. If I'll be kind of doing passing some other number over here, let's say 7. So it will be what will happen then? Anyone knowing that? If I'm doing df.head and I'm not passing any number through it, it's giving me first 5 rows. But if I do df.head and in that I pass 7, what will it be? What is the result I will be getting? Yeah, first 7 rows. It will be showing me the details of the first 7 rows. Yeah, df.head 7, as you can see, will be, yeah, we got the first 7 rows. So if anyone is not able, I just asked this, but we are not expecting you to know all this. So if anyone didn't know, you don't need to get disappointed. This is just the beginning of our session. So when I will be doing df.tell, you guys can easily guess it. Ek df.head tha, head tha, and it was giving me the first 5 rows by default. df.tell hai, so it will of course give me the last 5 rows. Obviously, if I pass any other number, it will give me that number of rows, that number of rows from the last. Then next is the df.describe. I really like this part because it tells us all about each and every details about the column. So these are the columns, row number, customer ID, and all the 14 columns. It has kind of told me about the distribution of my data. So you can look at this age column. It has given me there are 10,000 age column, then the mean, then the standard deviation, the minimum value, which is present in this age, the maximum value, what is the 25th percentile, the 50 percentile and 75 percentile. So can you guess just one line of one word of code, I implemented it and I got all the information regarding all the columns. Abhi main khud se baithti agar calculate karne ke liye just the mean of this age, what I would have done, I would have taken all this 10,000 values separately, added them, then again divided by 10,000, and then I would have got the mean of only age. But I am executing just one word, I'm writing just one word, and then I'm getting the details of all the columns. So yes, that's the beauty of coding. So yeah, we got some information about our data. Next, we'll be moving to the data pre-processing. As I have already told you, we need to process our data before feeding it to our model. So do you guys have any doubt till now, or we can proceed further? Do you guys have any doubt? No? Okay, cool. Fine. So moving forward, here we will be focusing on data pre-processing part. Here we'll be processing our data so that we can get more and more information about our, we got the information about our data and now we'll be processing it. Processing mainly involves removing the null values. Let me show you. When I click on df.info, this is normal, guys, see, I know some of you are there who don't know Python, and if you're not able to understand it, you don't need to get disheartened. You can just refer the the 4 topics I provided you. You can just refer those lectures regarding those topics. You can just get started with Python, and we will also be providing you recording of the session, so you will be able to access it whenever you want after learning Python also. But if you will be listening to us and attending this live session, you will be getting an overall idea. Maybe you will be getting an intuition kind of thing, which will inspire you to learn more by yourself. So yeah, so basically Python codes. So df.info, that was our variable. You do .info and you get all the information regarding regarding all the columns. So these are the columns, this is the data type, and this is the null count. So you guys tell me, what does null count means here? Not empty, yeah. Okay, we are, I guess it's going to be 7. The session is, I guess we are going to make it till 7:30. I guess you guys are fine with it if we extend the session to 7:30, because I need to explain all this part to you, like, with as much as clarity I can. So are you guys fine with like extending the session to 7:30? Yeah, sure. So we'll be doing df.info, as some of you told it's showing me the non-empty values. So look, while collecting this data, some errors can occur, or like suppose this person, this Obina, suppose, or suppose this she has like by chance she has not mentioned about her age, Obina, yeah. She has not mentioned about her age, so this will be treated as the null value. That part is empty. If that part would have been empty, that would have been treated as null value. But hum apne model ko jab ye data denge, our model won't be accepting this null value. It won't be trained properly. So what we need to do is, if there are certain null values, we need to deal with it. So as you can see in all of our columns, there are no null values. We are really lucky enough. Like you can say it's a blessing. Any other data set, normally usme null values hote hain. So how to deal with null values is one of the most important step of data processing, you can say, and you need to deal with it. Df.isNull.sum. Is specific data set mein nahi hai, but dealing with null values is you can say one of the most important thing, and you need to you guys need to do some research on that. Basically we use mean, median, mode and all that, but depended on the data set we'll be understanding how to fill the null values. You guys can, I guess, search it on your own, because we won't be needing this for today's session, for this data set. So when I do, you can see, I just ran this cell. So what it was telling me, the number of null counts. So since in each of the columns, the number of null counts was 10,000. So the this code is giving me the number of null counts. So you can see, since every column was having 10,000 null counts, so this here every column is having null zero as the null, like zero null values. So yeah, excuse me for that. I am just simply writing the code df.isNull.sum. What it is doing, it is calculating all the sum of null values in each column and presenting it over here. Then we'll be moving to df.nUnit. What it will be doing, it will be giving me the number of unique values in each column. Suppose age pakad lo, hamara 10,000 data points hai, but udhar 70 hi only unique values hai. Idhar hamara gender mein do hi categories hai. There are 10,000 data points, but we have only two categories, that is male and female. So it is just showing me each column mein kitne unique values hai. So as you can see, we sometime a bit earlier we talked about we don't need to fit all the columns to our model, as Lakshman told you, by taking the example of the number of hours a student studies and the marks he gets and the time he spends in cafeteria and all that. So he also mentioned that we don't need to take all the columns into consideration. So what we'll be doing over here, you can see hamare data set mein 10,000 data points hai. Idhar row number bhi 10,000 hai, customer ID bhi 10,000 hai, and surname somehow it's 2,000. So the number of jitne bhi number of rows hai utne customer ID bhi utna hi hai. So somehow it's not going to help us to find a pattern between our input and the output. So like it won't be serving as one of the significant columns. So what we can do is, instead of feeding all the insignificant columns to our model, we'll be dropping some of the less significant columns. So that is what we have done next. We have removed some of the columns. Okay, what I can, I just want to show you one thing. So yes. Can you guys tell me what is the difference between these two codes? You guys, you can try to figure out like देखो इन दोनों में क्या डिफरेंस होगा if I execute this. Any replies? Any guesses? Yeah, second code has a permanent effect on data frame. Yeah, correct. So no, we are not dealing with replacement of null values over here. I already mentioned that null values jo bhi hai, there are actually no null values, so we don't need to worry about them as of now. So what it is showing is, let me show you. When I select this column, so what it is showing, हमारा जो नॉर्मल इट इज सोइंग में 10,000 रोज इंटू 11 कॉलम्स सो आई हैड 14 कॉलम्स इट इज सोइंग में 10,000 रोज इंटू 11 कॉलम्स बिकॉज आई आस्क दैट यू मेक ए वेरिएबल लाइक यू जस्ट ड्रॉप दिस थ्री कॉलम्स दिस रो नंबर कस्टमर आई डी एंड सरनेम बिकॉज वी फाउंड दैट दिस थ्री कॉलम्स आर नॉट सिग्निफिकेंट एंड वी डोंट नीड टू फिट दिस टू आवर मॉडल सो वी डिसाइडेड टू ड्रॉप इट So when I executed this code, like I'm just listing out all the columns, this row number, call, customer ID and surname, I'm placing it in a list and I'm giving it as like assigning it to the columns. Then since I need to find it vertically, vertically, so I'm mentioning as axis is equal to 1. When you need to go horizontally or across the rows, we normally place axis is equal to 0. So I just I just executed this cell and it showed me df dot like the 10,000 rows and 11 columns. If I just like here it is showing me 11 columns, but if I again sorry I open the text part I guess yes. Yeah, I have already mentioned that head is used for the first 5 rows. You can see, abhi bhi 14 columns hi hain. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yeah, there are still 14 columns. Like I just wrote the code for dropping those 3 columns and it showed me that there are 11 columns, but still why am I having the 14 columns as I had earlier? I just wrote the code na like yeah what I want to do is I want to drop this three columns row number customer ID and surname because I don't think this is significant so I wrote this code idhar mujhe dikha raha hai ki 10,000 rows hai 11 columns hai and wo teen columns idhar nahi hai but when I am writing again df dot head If I will be writing df dot safe also, it will be giving me what it should give me. I just dropped this three columns, right? If I will be executing df dot safe, what will be the output I will be getting? Earlier it gave me 10,000 comma 14. So if I will be after executing this code, after executing this df, sorry, this one, after executing this one. If I will be writing df dot head df dot shape again, so what will be the output that I will be getting? Are you guys 10,014? Why 10,000 comma 14? I just dropped those three columns, right? Why am I getting 10,000 comma 14? Why some of you are telling 10,000 comma 14? Are you guys sure it's 10,000 comma 14 and not 10,000 comma 11? I just dropped those three columns, right? Is anyone there out? Like who thinks 10,000 comma 11 is the right answer? I just deleted those three columns, right? I guess you guys already know it. So yeah. So idhar kya ho raha hai? You're just dropping this columns, but this is not affecting to our original data set. So when I am doing df.save, it will be giving me 10,000,14. When I do df dot, when I run the same code, but here I will be writing in place is equal to true, what it will be doing, it will be doing permanent changes to my original data frame or the original df. So when I will be writing it again, I will be getting only 11 columns. So yeah, we have 11 columns over here. So guys, I think we need to speed up a bit because it's already 7. So yeah, so moving to the next part, EDA. EDA is the exploratory data analysis. Normally it is used for finding the hidden patterns in the data. You can say this is one of the most important thing we all should be knowing, because once you are into coding, like you all can understand this coding part. You all can understand what this df.shape means, df.drop mean. But when you are going to express your views to the other side, the customer side, you need they won't be understanding this code part. So what you need to do, you need to explain it to them what you mean through this plot, through this pie chart, through this count plot and all. So EDA is highly essential. And most importantly, जो तुम डेटा का इंफॉर्मेशन ये जो df dot head, df dot tell, df dot save, df dot info and all करके नहीं पा सकते हो, that could be in a better way understood through EDA. So yeah, EDA is very important. So when coming to EDA, let me use my Jamboard. So yeah, this is the exploratory data analysis. So we have, you can see we can do the analysis in three ways. First is the univariate analysis. Then the bivariate analysis. Then the third is analysis. So yeah, univariate, bivariate and multivariate, as the name suggests, I know tum logon ne guess kar hi liya hoga. Univariate yani ki will be analyzing one column, bivariate yani ki will be analyzing two columns, multivariate yani ki will be analyzing more than two columns. हमारा डेटा मेनली टू टाइप्स का होता है. एक होता है न्यूमेरिकल दूसरा होता है कैटेगोरिकल. आई नो सम ऑफ यू मस्ट बी थिंकिंग दैट वी आर गोइंग लाइक रियली टेकिंग डिफिकल्ट टर्मिनोलॉजीज दोज हु आर नॉट लाइक फुल्ली न्यू टू. That's just because we are discussing a lot of steps in a single day, but they're really easy and cool things. So we have data ko hum divide kar sakte hain numerical and categorical mein. So anyone out there who can say me numerical or categorical data mein kya difference hota hai? Okay, can you guys see me numerical or categorical mein kya difference hota hai? Anyone? Okay, fine. Let me. We have some replies. Yeah, you can see numericals only numbers. Categorical data is basically string type that can be categorized. Numericals are integer and float whereas yeah. So basically ये जो डी टाइप होता है नॉर्मली न्यूमेरिकल जो होता है दैट इज कंटिन्यूअस. इट हैज डी टाइप एज इंट एंड फ्लोट एंड द जो भी हमारा कैटेगोरिकल होता है इट हैज डी टाइप एज ऑब्जेक्ट. बट एट टाइम्स यू हैव टू बी वेरी केयरफुल अबाउट इट. तुम्हारे डेटा सेट में कभी कभार जो न्यूमेरिकल वैल्यूज होगा उसको एज ऑब्जेक्ट टाइप डी टाइप उसका होगा. यू विल बी नीडिंग टू डील विथ इट. बट नॉर्मली द थिंग इज व्हाट आई वांट टू से इज न्यूमेरिकल और कैटेगोरिकल में डिफरेंस. यू कैन सी दिस बैलेंस कॉलम ओवर हियर. यू कैन सी देयर आर नंबर्स सर्टेन 1255057389750075 एंड ऑल. सो दिस आर काइंड ऑफ कंटिन्यूअस थिंग्स. they have less unique values, you can say. So ye thoda numerical mein aa jayega. On the other hand, if I'm going to talk about gender, it has two categories only, male and female. Okay, so that was all the things I needed to tell you before that. I wanted you all to know before we could jump to exploratory data analysis. So moving on, first of all, we'll be taking into consideration the target column. You guys need to remember this while carrying out EDA. You will be doing the data analysis of all the columns, but you need to give certain importance to the target column. After all, it is our target column. I need to mention it to you. Target column is our for us in this data set. This is the bank churn prediction. So we want to find out if the customer stays or not. So what do you think is the target column for here? Let me take you to this one. We have got columns where, yeah, these are the columns. So I need to find out which customer stays or which customer exits. So what do you think is the target column for us? Target column yani ki hamara output column over here. Yeah, exited. So exited is our target column over here. So while doing EDA, what I prefer doing is I first prefer analyzing on our target column. So yeah, that's what I have done. DF exited. I have taken the exited column over here, and usme jitne bhi categories hai, each ke values count ke hai, DF exited dot value counts. Then I have kind of by length DF exited karke, this is simple maths. I have just found out its percentage. You can see category 0 ka 79.63% hai, category 1 ka 20.37% hai. This is simple maths. So I just tried finding ki 0 yani ki 79.63, 1 yani ki 20.37. 0 79.63, 0 yani ki kitne customers abhi bhi bank mein apna service continue kar rahe hai, 1 yani ki kitne customers bank ka service they have left the bank service. So what you think, more people are staying in the bank or more people have left the bank service? More people are preferring to stay in the bank, or they prefer staying. Zero means they are staying. So they have kind of stayed over there. So DF exited. Now I want to plot this using a pie chart. So this is basically a pie chart. I am sure you must be aware about pie chart. Ye is mainly circle form hota hai, and this is showing the percentage. This is the one that is those who are leaving, and zero, this indicates those who are staying. So I just want you guys to mark the difference between this two. Ye jo do figures hai, in dono mein difference kya hai? Okay, 2D, 3D. Yeah, so basically this looks more visually appealing, right? So what we have done, what I want you guys to understand that by writing 3 or 4 lines of more code, we can just do so much changes and make it more visually appealing and more informative. Most importantly, more informative. This was just showing 0, 1. This is showing exited, written, and kitna percentage written kar raha hai, and yeah, so what we have done is we have introduced labels exited, written, then count, DF exited, one, kitne person hai jo stay kar rahe hain, unka count hum liye hain, sorry, leave kar rahe hain, unka count liye hain, kitne person retain kar rahe hain, unka count liye hain. Then we are introducing it so that this one, this explode 0, 0.1, so that ye se slice hoke cut hokar aayega. Then we are increasing the figure size over here. Then we are passing all these things which we have written over here. AX1.py, and we are passing this as arguments, and then we are plotting this. So yeah, just some lines of code, and this looks more informative and more better. So that was we plotted. The next is the count plot. What the count plot does is this is the exited column. It is showing me the count, kitna frequency dikha raha hai each category ka. तो हमारे एग्जिटेड में दो था यूनिक वैल्यू 0 और 1, आइदर दे आर स्टेइंग और दे आर रिटेनिंग. So it is showing me the count of 0, it is showing me the count of 1. So basically I have used the pie chart and the count plot only to show the count of 0 and this and show the count of 1. Like this is 79%, this is what was that? That was 20, near about 20%. So what we'll be doing next next is mainly hamare jo categorical plots hote hain, we make use like it's no hard and first rule, but normally what we do to plot the categorical plots, we make use of count plot. We just I just showed you the count plot, and we also make use of pie chart. न्यूमरिकल का न्यूमरिकल के केस में क्या होता है, उनके यूनिक वैल्यूज कुछ ज्यादा ही होते हैं. सो काउंट प्लॉट के थ्रू एनालाइज करना इतना इजी नहीं होता है, बट स्टिल यू कैन गो फॉर देम इफ द यूनिक वैल्यूज आर लेस. व्हाट वी बेसिकली डू इज वी गो फॉर डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन प्लॉट. वी गो फॉर हिस्टोग्राम्स. Yeah, so like this we can go on. So basically I have and one of the most important thing, box plot, that is my personal favorite. I will be letting you know like iska like it's not just used for plotting, iska aur bhi significance hai and why I prefer using this. We will be discussing that within 5 minutes. So yeah, this is simple Python code. We are using SNS. SNS is we have used that for seaborn. If you remember, we wrote import seaborn as SNS. So that is it. SNS.countplot. We are using this countplot, which is from the seaborn library. We are So and we are passing this arguments as x is the gender column and exit it. It is equal to df. Okay, fine. Can you see the next graph I am showing? Can you mark the difference? Here also I am doing the count plot using seaborn, and I am passing over here gender, and this is the data I am passing. Like ye jo gender column hai wo hamara count plot kidhar kidhar se lega, is df variable mein na. So that's what we have done. But can you mark the difference? This when I write this hue is equal to exited, what is happening? And when I am not writing this hue is equal to exited, what is happening? Can you see the four graph, four plot aaye hain, idhar do plot aaye hain. What this four plot mean? What this two plot mean? Anyone? Like 7:13 already. We're distributing, huh? Yeah. Yeah, right. So that's what we have been doing. What it is showing us, isne gender ko male and female ka to plot kar diya isne. What this is doing extra is it's showing me female mein kitne log retain kiye hain, female mein kitne log how many have left the service, male mein kitne log retain kiye hain, male mein kitne log service leave kar chuke hain. So that's what it is showing to me. This is just I introduced one word extra, and can you see how much difference it is making? Because if I'm seeing this graph, I can easily say ki male ke count zyada hain. Hum jo data set liye hain udhar, the count of male is more than the female. But when you see this, you can understand, despite the fact that the count of male is more, the churning rate of female is higher. Can you see? Count male ka zyada hai, but the churning rate of female is higher. So can just we introduced one word, and that's how the insights we get improvises. So yeah, we did the same for geography, the same thing. So I won't be explaining it to you. And this is the for the rest of the things I have made use of box plot. So box plot, I think I need to explain it to you. So let me just take two columns, and after that I will be explaining it to you about box column. Yeah, just a second. What should I take the next? tenure maybe. So yeah, I have made, I'm going to plot the box plot and here exited ke terms mein humne x mein pass kiya hai, y mein we have passed here tenure and here I have passed age. So and hue I have already told you and data, it will be searching all this in our df, that is the where we have stored. So yeah, this is what our plot looks like. So can you like mark the difference between these two? Ye jo like black thing hai, ye idhar nahi hai, this dot things, it is not present over here but it is present over here. So that is what I meant when I said that my personal favorite is box plot. Let me have anyone told you. Yeah, so can you guys tell me what those dot things or the black things over there present? Anyone who has studied the box plot can only say that answer. So so if others who like don't know this, they don't need to be disappointed. I'm just asking like if anyone knows or not. Yeah, outliers. So I will be telling you what is outliers. Let me open my Jamboard. Okay, we need to be really quick now. So if I can search for the box plot over here. Yeah, this one will work. Second, it's is it visible to you guys, this image? So yeah, this is a box plot and this indicates the median. You can see the 50 percentile value. This indicates the 25th percentile value. Abhi thoda sa aisa lagega dimag ke upar se jayega, but trust me, this is easy. That's just because we are discussing a lot of stuff in a single day. Thoda sa waisa lag sakta hai, but yeah, it's okay. So this is the 25th percentile. 25th percentile yani ki I'm sure you must be acquainted with the percentile system after you all have appeared for JEE. So yeah, so 25 percentile yani ki you can let me show you through this. So yeah, if I'm considering this age column and this one, that is the 01, those who have written, so iska 25 percentile ye hai. So I can say that that 25% of the people or those who what retained are below the age of 30, and 75 percentile of people who retained are below the age of near about 42. So that is what mean by 75 percentile, 25 percentile, and this is the median, that is 50 percentile. So where it is, that is what we mean by here. And this is, you can see this is written something like Q1 minus 1.5 into IQR, Q3 plus 1.5 into IQR. IQR basically is the interquartile range. It is basically the difference between the 75 percentile value and the 25 percentile value. IQR is this quantity, the difference between this 75 percentile and 25 percentile. So what we are doing is we are, let me check, okay, fine. So what we are doing is this is the maximum value, that is Q3 plus 1.5 into IQR. This is the maximum value and this is the minimum value. What we mean by maximum value and minimum value is this. I found the 75 percentile, I found the 25 percentile by differentiating, by finding the difference. I found the IQR, that is the interquartile range. then I will be putting this value, 75th percentile value plus 1.5 into IQR, and anything, any point which comes after this, I will not be take, I will be considering some that as outlier, and anything which comes below, like I'll be taking the 25th percentile, I will be subtracting 1.5 into IQR, and I will be considering that as outliers. Okay, मैंने consider कर लिया outliers, but ये outliers actually है क्या? So outliers is basically which behaves different from rest of the data points. Let me tell you. Suppose I'm thinking there is some age column over there. We have a age column. Ages suppose 27, 32, 50. Sorry, 30. Okay, fine, 33. We have a age 50. We have a age 40. So maximum suppose. उधर एक प्रश्न आ गया, he has let me write over here, okay, he has the age of 70. So ये max suppose 20 से हमारा age, normally सारे values 20 से 50 के अंदर आ रहे हैं, but we have a value 70 and we also have someone with the age of 15. So this two will be considered as outliers because they behave different from rest of the data points. And now how our like model is affected by outliers, or data is affected by outliers, is suppose I say that salary of a person, of some certain persons, and udhar sabka salary suppose range kar hai 25k se 70k mein. But suddenly someone comes and he like inserts Bill Gates' salary inside that. अब मैं जब mean find out करने जाऊंगी, ये जो salary column, just because of the single person, it will increase by a lot. So won't that be misleading? So why should it? So that's why I should be treating this Bill Gates as outlier, and I will should be removing this. Like that's the concept. So that's what I wanted to say you, like that's the difference. This is the 25th percentile, this is the 75th percentile, this is the 50th percentile, and these are the outliers. Are you guys clear till now? Or do you have any doubts in that box plot? Are you guys clear till now? Or you are having some doubt in box plot and outliers? Okay, fine. So let's we need to quickly cover all the rest of the parts. So now we found the outliers, next we'll be focusing on removing those outliers. So to find to remove the outlier, first what you need to do is distribution plot. If you have remembered, I told you that we can make use, I mentioned about the distribution plot in the EDA part. So yeah, we just wrote snrs.distplot, and in the argument section we passed dfh. So we found out the distribution. अब यू मस्ट बी थिंकिंग आउटलायर रिमूवल का डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन से क्या रिलेशन? द थिंग इज यू नीड टू फाइंड द डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन टू बी एबल टू रिमूव द आउटलायर, एंड इसके डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन से पता चलता है ये स्क्यूड है. स्क्यूड यानी कि लेट मी शो यू. नॉर्मल वर्सेस स्क्यूड. Where can I show you more perfectly? Which will be the best one? Let us take this one or this one. Yeah, so you can see this is symmetric. This is the normal distribution. जो थोड़ा सा इसे slanting होके होगा अभी के लिए तुम समझ लो वो skewed है. So what we can do is we will be plotting the distribution plot, and we will be finding whether it's normal distribution or skewed. Since it's skewed distribution, we will be removing the outlier using the interquartile range. I mentioned about the IQR, right? This thing IQR. So using that only we'll be removing the outliers. And agar hamara distribution is normal hua hota, we would have used something called as the Z-score method. But we won't be getting into that now. Since we are really short in time now, So just understand this, this is skewed distribution, so I am using the interquartile range. So what I am doing is, I am simple hai, jo humne pehle bhi kiya tha, I am finding the percentile, 25th percentile value. This is the code for finding the 25th percentile of the age column. If I will be passing suppose tenure over here instead of this age, and if I will be writing percentile 25 is equal to DF, उसके अंदर एज के जगह मैंने टेन्योर डाल दिया, डॉट क्वांटाइल 0.25, सो व्हाट विल इट बी गिविंग टू मी गाइस, कम ऑन, यू नीड टू आंसर मी दिस, यू नीड टू टेल मी द आंसर. इफ इंस्टेड ऑफ एज आई विल बी पासिंग टेन्योर, परसेंटाइल 25 में क्या मेरे को मिलेगा, विल इट बी डिफरेंट फ्रॉम द एज, अगर इफ आई विल बी पासिंग द एज, कैन यू गाइस अंडरस्टैंड द क्वेश्चन, यू नीड टू टेल द आंसर टू मी, और एल्स व्हाट आई हैव बीन एक्सप्लेनिंग इट टू यू, आई विल फील लाइक यू डिडंट गेट इट. What I mean to say is, if percentile 25 is equal to DF, isme I will be passing tenure instead of age. Anyone? Okay, let me give you a hint. Percentile 25 is equal to DF H dot quantile 0.25. What it is doing is, it is giving me the 25th percentile value, the Q1 value of the age column. So if instead of age I will be passing any other column, वो मुझे क्या देगा? This is providing me the 25th percentile value, the Q1 value of age column. If instead of age I will be replacing this age with any other column, what will it be giving me? Yeah, perfect. Q1 value of tenure. So yeah, that's what I have done. This is percentile 25. This is percentile 75. That is Q3. IQR Q3 minus Q1, the upper limit and the lower limit. I already mentioned that anything beyond this will be considered as outliers. So yeah, that I am fine. So for that, I am finding the upper limit at the lower limit. I am finding all the rows where the age is having value, like all the rows where the age column has value greater than the upper limit, because all these points are the outliers for me. You can see 359 rows. And I'm finding all the rows where the age column is having values less than this lower limit, less than this one, greater than this one. I'm just trying to find out those, and I find that lower limit se kam ke koi outlier nahi hai, but upper limit se zyada wale udhar outliers hai. Wahi to dikhaya tha hume, like beyond this, there were outliers beyond this and not beyond this, like beyond this and not beyond this, there were no outliers for the age column. So what I did, I just did all these changes, like DF column में से जितने भी rows हैं जिसका values upper limit से कम है, I will be storing that only to DF, and the all other rest I will not be storing. So all these columns, all these rows will be deleted from my original data frame. So next, I guess you guys are clear about the outlier removal part. थोड़ा सा first हो रहा होगा, but yeah. It's okay, we are really short in time, so we can't do anything. You guys can, like, we'll be providing you the recording session. You can go through it again so that you will be able to understand it perfectly. So yeah, so encoding, what I mean, encoding mein kya hota hai? Some of you have already mentioned categorical data jo hota hai, that is mainly in the form of string. So what we need, when I will be providing that string to my model, our model will be saying that I can only understand numbers. So if you are going to provide me strings, it's of no use to me. So मुझे क्या करना पड़ेगा? मेरे मॉडल को मुझे ensure करना पड़ेगा कि मैं जो भी डेटा दे रही हूँ, that should be in number format. So जो भी string है, what should I do? Should I be eliminating all the categorical columns because they have the data type string? Will that be good? Should I be eliminating all those which are not be? No, we can do that. Like those columns may be useful. So what I need to do is I need to encode them. I need to convert them into numbers. So this is where the encoding concept comes into play. So this is scikit-learn. This is actually a library. Jo you will be, if you are already into machine learning, you must be knowing about scikit-learn. But if you're hearing it from the first time, this is basically the library, and we import a lot of things from here, like to carry, like to carry out our aim or what, like this label encoder thing, this was present in the sklearn.preprocessing and we imported it from here. So coming to the encoding part, what we have done is, this is df.geography. I have label encoded by fit transforming this column. Like ye jo df.geography hai, isko maine encode kiya using this code. I made this encoder, label encoder maine import kiya. Then I made this encoder is equal to label encoder and I'm using that encoder to fit transform my geography column. Like I want to geography mein jo bhi tha, hamara Spain, France aur Germany tha, usko maine encode kiya yani ki numerical values ko convert kiya. वैसे ही जेंडर जो है उसको मैंने अगेन न्यूमेरिकल वैल्यूज को कन्वर्ट किया एंड ये रैंडम न्यूमेरिकल वैल्यूज को कन्वर्ट नहीं होते हैं. व्हाट आई एम मेकिंग यूज इज समथिंग नोन एज लेबल एनकोडिंग. यू गाइस नीड टू लिसन टू मी केयरफुली नाउ बिकॉज आई नो थोड़ा कंफ्यूज हो गए होंगे. सो व्हाट इज एनकोडिंग इज वी आर ऑलरेडी पास्ट 7:30. सो या लेबल एनकोडिंग में क्या होता है, व्हाट आई एम डूइंग इज suppose this is the geography column, this is the gender column. Geography mein suppose Spain hai, France hai, sorry France hai, Germany hai. So when I encode, what will be happening is it will be assigned suppose value 0, it will be assigned value 1, it will be assigned value 2. So what will be happening, suppose I have a column, either geography Spain hai, either France hai, either Germany hai, and here we have Spain again. If I have assigned this 0, this is 1 and this 2, whenever that column will be occurring, once we encode getting geography column mein, aur hume Spain, France and Germany nahi milega, rather we'll be getting 0, we'll be getting for it as 1, we'll be getting it as 2. And again for Spain, I will be getting as 0. For France, I will be getting, wherever France is there, I will be getting as 1. Wherever Germany is there, I will be getting it as 2. So this is how it's converted. Similarly, gender column ko bhi usne waise hi convert kiya. Male ko suppose 0 de diya, female ko 1 de diya. So that's what we have done here. Now you can see the changes. Earlier mera idhar Spain, France, Germany aa raha tha, idhar mera abhi 012 aa raha tha. This I need to turn on my charger. Wait a minute. Yeah, fine. So idhar pehle 0 Spain, France aur Germany aa raha tha and now it's coming 01 and 2. Earlier it was coming male and female, now it's coming 0 and 1. So can you guys give me a confirmation? Are you guys getting bored or what? This session is like have got extended a lot. So so you guys are fine. Well, we will just be taking 15 more minutes, I guess. So you guys are like okay with us continuing for the next 15 minutes? So we can go on. Are you guys like, you still have that energy you had during the start of the session, or we should be taking it to tomorrow? We can continue. You guys are like in the state of learning, right? Okay, fine. So this is so we learned about label encoding over here, but the thing which happens in case of geography is that, as Lakshman has already explained it to you, I guess, about that weight bias concept, we find that this geography is getting converted to 0, 1 and 2. So what will be happening is hamara machine jo hoga, it's just like a kid. Whatever we fit to it, it just gets trained on that. So I'm just telling that maine encode kar diya Germany ke liye 2, Spain ke liye 0, France ke liye 1. So what it will be doing is it will be thinking that this Germany in the geography column has more weightage. Like it will be giving this some more importance than this Spain and France. So there we need to do one extra step. There's something known as one-hot encoding comes into our rescue. We'll be telling our model you don't need to prioritize just one category. For that, I will be just carrying out one more step so that you won't be like favoring anyone or you won't be biased. kind of thing. We are just telling that to a model, you can think of that. So yeah, what we'll be doing is one hot encoding ke case mein kya hota hai, hamara abhi Spain, France, Germany. लेबल एनकोडिंग के केस में क्या हो रहा था, ये जीरो, ये वन, ये टू को कन्वर्ट हो जा रहा था. तो वन हॉट एनकोडिंग के केस में क्या होगा, सपोज दिस इज स्पेन अगेन ओवर हियर, दिस इज फ्रांस ओवर हियर, विल बी हैविंग थ्री मोर कॉलम, स्पेन, फ्रांस, जर्मनी. सो इफ इट्स इट्स स्पेन, आई विल बी गेटिंग ज्योग्राफी स्पेन में वन होगा, ज्योग्राफी फ्रांस में जीरो होगा, ज्योग्राफी जर्मनी में जीरो होगा. Then again, here I will be getting as 1, here I will be getting as 0. Yeh Germany hai. So can you guys tell me what is the set of values I need to enter here? Just remember, yeh idhar Spain tha, toh geography Spain mein 1 aa raha tha, baaki do columns mein 0 ja raha tha. Idhar France hai, toh idhar 0 hai and France mein 1 aa raha tha. If it is Germany, in which column I need to pass 1 and in which columns I need to pass 0? Can you guys say me? Tell the answer. 001, yeah, perfect. It's going to be 001. So yeah, it's you got it. Sorry, this one for Germany. Similarly for Spain, it's going to be 100. So yeah, is there for this way our model won't be understanding that we are providing or we are being biased towards one category. So that's the extra step we have carried over here. And since we have already converted to geography 01, so after carrying out, it's giving me geography 12 and geography 0 is there. But the thing is, what I have done over here, let me show you. So what I have done is I have added one extra thing known as drop first is equal to true. So we have geography 0, geography 1 and geography 2 normally. But when I do this thing, draw first is equal to true, what happens is geography zero gets like removed from the data frame. The reason being, hum geography zero ko easily identify kar sakte hain whether geography zero hai ya nahi. Kaise? When I don't know what's happening, it's not moving to that side. Okay, wait. Yeah, geography one, geography two, geography zero kab hoga? Jab ज्योग्राफी जीरो कब होता है, जब ज्योग्राफी जीरो में वन होगा एंड ज्योग्राफी वन एंड ज्योग्राफी टू में तभी जीरो होता है. सो व्हेनेवर एनी टू कॉलम्स इज हैविंग, दिस टू कॉलम्स आर हैविंग जीरो, यू कैन अंडरस्टैंड दैट ज्योग्राफी इधर ज्योग्राफी जीरो है हमारा. लाइक एंड लेट मी ओपन माई जैमबोर्ड एंड टू एक्सप्लेन इट टू यू. सपोज आई विल बी ड्रॉपिंग दिस स्पेन वाला कॉलम and I will be giving you France and Germany. So can you guys tell me either kaun se rows mein Spain occur kya hoga? Of course, like kahan occur kya hoga? If this is France, this is one over here. One is in the Germany column, so it's Germany. And since France or Germany mein kahin bhi one nahi hai, to of course ye hoga hamara the category which the column which we have removed, that is Spain. So that is it what we have done over here. I just removed the geography zero because it will lead to something known as dummy variable trap. I don't think I will be able to explain it to you now, but yeah, remember it. Yani ki geography zero, one and two, those features will be highly correlated and wo last ko hamare model ke performance mein that will be causing some issues. So you must be dropping it. So yeah, moving to the next step, that is splitting the target column and the independent features. As I have already told you why, that is the exited column is our targeted column. And we need to separate it so that we could clearly give to our machine that yeah, take this as input and take this as output and you find the pattern. Like the 2 and 3 addition and then giving as input and 5 as the output, we gave that as an example. So that thing only, so we'll be separating this ye data set mein kya ek saath occur kar raha hai, so what we'll be doing, we'll be separating this exited column from the rest of the features and then we'll be giving storing the rest of the features in X and storing the exited column in Y. So this is how we'll be separating our input and output features so that we can later fit it to our machine or our model. So yeah, this is I have just dropped the exited columns over here, exited column from the data frame and stored it in x and y I have taken the exited column into consideration. So this is what my x after dropping exited columns look like, and this is what my exited column looks like. It gets converted to an array. So we just understood the separation of the input and the output, like the splitting of them into x and y. Now let's move to oversampling. So now you must be wondering, abhi ye naya kaun sa term aa gaya oversampling. So as I have already shown you guys, yeah, this one. You can see इधर जो category zero है उस that is more, like having more quantity it is 79% and the category one it is 20%. So you can see हमारे data set जो है imbalanced है, क्योंकि एक category के values हमने जो data provide किया है उधर एक category ज्यादा है and दूसरे category कम है. So this data set is imbalanced. The problem with this imbalanced data set will be feeding this to our model. No worries, it will be accepting that. But जब हम prediction की बात आएगी, what it will be doing? It will be more biased towards predicting, like giving zero as the answer. Like it won't be giving us the right answer. Rather, since उसको हमने input में like training करते time ही ज़्यादा वही data दिया था जिधर zero ज़्यादा time occur कर रहा था, तो it will be biased towards it. So what we need to do is in that case is we need to balance the data set, and for that we have made use of oversampling. There are other techniques known as undersampling, but here we have made use of oversampling, so I will be explaining it to you. Oversampling ke bhi bahut sare ways hote hain, jaise random sampler, and we have made use of synthetic. Let me, like, I don't remember what the full form right now. Yeah, where is it? Yeah, you can see overcoming class imbalance using SMOT technique, synthetic minority oversampling technique. Okay, that's it. So we have made use of that only. So what we are going to do, suppose hamara zero jo hai, suppose hamara 10k data points hai, hamara zero near about 8k data points are there. In one we have over 2k data points. So what we'll be doing is, using this 2k data points, I will be creating some extra data points. So can you guys tell me how many extra data points I need to make so that this zero category and this one category will be same? Yeah, 6k. You guys are pretty fast. So I need to make more 6k columns, using this 2k columns. This will sum up to 8k, and my data set will be balanced, and it will know, my model can no more be biased towards one category, and it will be giving me better results with better accuracy. So yeah, that's what we have done. We have imported this synthetic minority oversampling technique from this library, and we have passed our x and y, that is the independent features, in the target column and stored them in this new variables, and that's what oversampling was, and that's how we balanced our model. Then the next part comes, the splitting the train and test data. So this is highly essential. You guys need to carry this whenever you are like working on your model. This is essential so that you can in a better way understand your model. You can in a better way evaluate your model. For example, what we do is, while model evaluation, we'll be dividing our x into two sets, that is x train. And x test, and here we will be dividing it into y train. And y test. So the reason being that we'll be passing x train and y train for training. We'll be giving this model. We'll be giving you, take this input, you take this output, you analyze the pattern, you analyze what's how this extreme, this independent features are related to my target column. You just go and find the pattern. And now I will be giving you the new set of data known as X-test. You tell me what will be my output. You tell me what will be my Y-bred. So once I get the Y-bred, I already have my Y-test against this X-test. So what I can do is, I can compare this Y-test and Y-bred. And see how accurate my model is. So that's what we have done. What we have done is we have passed this X and Y that which was oversampled through the trend test split. For trend test split, we also need to import one model. I guess I had run it already while importing libraries. Yeah, from sklearn.model selection, import trend test split. Before carrying out that, you need to ensure that you imported trend test split from sklearn.model selection. So I passed X and Y, then test size. It will be test size 0.2, yani ki train agar mera 100 data points hai, to 80 will be coming to train and 20 will be coming to test. So I splitted my train and test data, and we are to the second last part of our today's session, that is scaling. Are you guys clear till now? Okay, fine. So let's be quick now. So yeah, scaling is necessary because let me give you one example. DF dot. Yeah, DF to describe. Can you see this balance column? So you can see this minimum quantity, it's zero, and maximum quantity is, it's like 250,000 something. So minimum is this much and maximum is this much. So you can see like iska range kitna zyada hai. And if you talk about this, which column I should take next? Maybe I can take this Hashia card. Okay, minimum is ka zero hai and maximum is ka one hai. So you can see in logo ka ranges kaise differ kar hai. Iska kitna kam range hai, iska kitna zyada range hai. Bahut times to aisa hota hoga ye jo bhi idhar values honge, they would be in like different units. So to deal with all this, our scaling comes into play. And we have made use of standard scaler over here. So standard scaler, just for that scaling purposes. So what I will be telling you what it does is, scaling ke other techniques bhi hai, like normalization, but we are focusing on standardization, that is use of standard scaler. So what happens is, suppose I have a age column, either age here 27, 32, 50. So what will be, what I will be doing is, I will be replacing this, let's name it as edge dash. उधर क्या होगे ये जो I will be scaling down each of the values. What I will be doing, I will be carrying out 27 minus the mean of all this. Mean of here you can say age mean and age का standard deviation. So I will be like scaling down. So जो भी result आएगा I will be writing it over here. Similarly 32 को 50 को इस वजह से क्या हो जाएंगे हमारे एक within certain limit हमारे quantity scale down हो जाएंगे in such a way that their mean is zero and their standard deviation is one. Geometric intuition iska kya hota hai ki like agar hamara data points aise the earlier, consider this as the data points and this was the mean earlier. So after scaling what will happen is this data points will gather in such a way that this mean is, their mean will be. So geometric intuition ye hota hai, and this is the mathematical formula. So if you did okay. So yeah, what we did is that was the mathematical and the geometric intuition behind standard scalar, and this is the code part. We imported standard scalar, and to that we passed xtrain. Based on this xtrain, it will be finding out our standard deviation and mean, and then we'll be scale. Sorry, I forgot to run this. And then we kind of scale down the train and test. So that was all about scaling, and finally we have come to the last part of the session. I guess logistic regression, Lakshman has already explained to it. So about that sigmoid function and all that, like 0.5 se niche aayega to it's going to be 0, 0.5 se zyada aayega to it's going to be 1 and all thing. So we will just be focusing on the coding part here. So we are focusing on logistic regression, but let me tell you guys, logistic regression is not the only algorithm that you find in machine learning for classification purposes. There are others known as distant reclassifier, Gaussian naive bias, but we won't be getting into that now. We are just focusing on logistic regression. Lakshman has already told you about the statistical and mathematical part. If you have, I guess you guys are still with me, or I'm having some network issues. I don't know, my file is not getting saved. Are you guys there? Is my voice audible? Can you give me? Yeah. Okay, cool. So, logistic regression. This is the logistic regression. So I just imported it from sklearn.linear model. Then I'm creating the classifier model. I'm passing the xtrain scaled and ytrain. I'm passing the xtrain and ytrain basically, and I'm fitting it to a model. And after I run this, मैंने मॉडल को अपना xtrain and ytrain दे दिया. Now I will be telling it to xtest ले and मुझे y prediction का value निकाल के दे. So this is what I am doing. Once I get all the predicted values of xtest, I will be storing it in ypred. And the next step is, what I will be doing, as I have mentioned, anyone, I have passed xtrain and ytrain into the model. Then I stored all the values of xtest into ypred. And next step will be, anyone, I mentioned it over here, right? Somewhere, it was somewhere over here. Abhi kuch samajh mein nahi aa raha hoga isko dekhkar, but yeah, xtrain and ytrain maine pass kiya, xtest अपने मॉडल को दिया. देन अभी मैं उसको बोल रही हूँ इससे लेके तो ट्रेन हो जा, अभी तो एक्स टेस्ट ले, मुझे प्रेडिक्ट करके वाई प्रेड का वैल्यू दे. सो माय नेक्स्ट स्टेप विल बी, चेक व्हाट आई नीड टू चेक. या आई विल बी चेकिंग मेरा मॉडल कितना अच्छा परफॉर्म कर रहा है, इसीलिए ही तो हम कर रहे हैं. लाइक अगर या सो दिस इज इट, ypred, we are importing something known as accuracy score, which is giving us the accuracy. So ytest and ypred mein accuracy it's coming to be 0.74, itna acha nahi hai, but yeah, that's it. We learned like pretty cool stuffs today. You can kind of carry out more feature engineering techniques. You could deal with this data set more clearly, like in a more better way. You can try it on your part and try to improve those accuracy. So I guess that was all for today's session. Do you guys have any doubt? It's already 8. Like it was planned to be, like we planned to end the session at 7, but yeah, we took 1 hour extra, but it's okay. So do you guys are having any doubt, or you understood everything? Okay, fine. So that's it for today. Let me like
hello.
Hello. Yeah. Lakshman, are you saying something?
Yeah. So this is all about today's machine learning concept. So tomorrow we're gonna learn deep learning. Priyanka, could you explain that?
Yeah, exactly. So today we just just didn't learn about machine learning. We learned like hell lot of things. We learned about scaling, oversampling. We learned about features like feature selection and a lot of things. I have already shared the notebook with you. We'll be sharing the recording also. And we like literally learned a lot of things. Anyone, can you like, if you're having the patience and energy, can you like write down what we learned today? Like what new things you came across today? When will there be the club induction? Subhankar Panda, are you in first year? Okay, so GDSC, it's like we had the club inductions recently, and as far as I know, anyone can be the part of GDSC. You just need to register for it. And club inductions of GDSC, I think it's like it's a 1 year contract kind of thing you take from the like Google community. You can see we'll be telling you about the inductions details like tomorrow. Maybe we'll be implementing you about the Google Developers inductions, but there is no such selection technique in Google Developers Club. Anyone who is interested enough, anyone who like wants to learn more things, they all are part of the club. Like we are not going, Google Developers Students Club is not going to have any test to like to check your ability and all. We like, if you are interested to learn, the club is always open for you. So yeah, that was about like we got diverted into some other topic, but yeah, that was all for today. Let me stop sharing my screen. So yeah, that's it for today. Will there be any goodies from Google after completion? Yeah, there will be there will be goodies, but you need to attend all the 3 days events and there will be a competition which will be launched after that. You need to like perform well in there, and then you will be selected for the for getting the goodies. So yeah, that was all about the machine learning session today. So yeah, thank you, Asis. So we like pretty much learned a lot of things today, starting from like the whole machine learning development life cycle, starting from the data preparation part, where we learned about let me go to the table of content so that I can tell you. Yeah, from importing libraries, importing data, the data information, data pre-processing, then EDA part. Feature engineering, we learned about outlier removal, encoding, oversampling, scaling. Then we move to the machine learning part. And tomorrow we'll be moving to the deep learning part. And we will be showing like same model without doing any extras things. How when we pass the same X-train and Y-train to our deep learning model, uska performance kaise and uska accuracy kaise better ho jata hai. Why deep learning is preferred over machine learning at times, and when it is preferred, and how the machine learning and deep learning are different from each other. You will be getting an overall idea on neural networks tomorrow. So yeah, I think we need to end this session. So we will soon be sharing with you the feedback form, you could tell us how like did you like, whether you like the session or not, and how much you like, you could rate us. So yeah, so now we will be ending the session soon. So do you guys have any doubt? Let me ask for the last time, because we'll be wrapping up the session soon. Are you guys there? Okay. In the outlier section. Okay, in the outlier section, the box plot thing, right? Nishikant, where did you have the doubt exactly in the outlier section? The outlier section, thoda zyada terms ho gaye honge. What you can do is you can just go and search something related to the removal of outlier. and you will be able to, I guess, better understand it. If you are still not able to like get into it, you can contact any of us. We'll be like more than happy to help you. Let me check. I guess we should wrap up the session now. Nishikant, it will be better if you do some research over there, and we'll be providing the recording. You can like see this part again and again. If you are still not able to, we'll be there. Okay, fine. So did you guys enjoy the session? Like what will be your feedback for the session today? Yes, a lot. Okay. Did you, okay, we kind of tried our best to make you understand. Thoda bahut, thoda bahut ho gaya hoga hectic, thoda zyada, like for the pure beginners, I know you don't need to get disheartened. I know many first years have joined. Those who don't know Python, you don't need to get disheartened. This was this was not completely a beginner session, but we tried so that you could understand. You just guys need to keep learning on your part, and we will be there to help you guys when you need it. We'll be soon providing you with the recording, and whenever you want, you can go through this. So that's it for today. Thanks a lot for like staying with us till now. See you tomorrow, guys. So how many of you are going to come to tomorrow's session? Can I have a like, can I know how many of you are going to come tomorrow? Yeah, cool. So see you guys tomorrow. You guys can go on and revise all these things. I have provided with you with two blocks. We'll be providing you with the recording and the feedback form. And I have already shared with you the Google Colab notebook. And if anyone finds it a bit confusing, don't worry. We just completed a lot of steps today. Start self-learning, you will be able to understand it. So yeah, that's it for today, guys. Thank you. Have a nice day. See you tomorrow. You can start leaving now.